You can see it anyway, right? And with that, we'll let Professor Lee basically start the second half of his two lectures.
Thanks everyone. Things short, but so the second lecture, last time we talked about the interface part and some conventional device. And this time I want to go, obviously the device innovation part is important. And we want to show some results of inverted organic solid cells in polymer and solution process tandem OPV. Okay, in this part, Maurice will give a very nice talk of the overview of a tandem device. And she shows this, what is a stacked tandem. You have this V-shaped tandem, and so on, and a parallel tandem. So there is no need for me to repeat anything like that. So when I write this one, solution process, the tandem OPV, this thing is we restrict the limited to so two terminals. Okay, just to follow what we have before on the interface, that we talk about the conventional solid cells, you start with this high work function electrode, and the other opposite side of the sandwich is the lower function one. And the concept of building on this ITO substrate and build this inverted polymer solar cell, this one happens about the same time, I think, in U theory and also in aerial. Later I'll show you the publications there. So just a little bit like what do we do there? Why do we want to get the inverted polymer solar cell? A little bit of background so that you will know that it might be interesting to you. So initially that's okay, PTOR PSS, well, it's very widely used. It's in PMP lab and in OLED. You see those history as you really go to the 1980s there. It's a very well used one, and in 1980 applications, people have found that because of the acidic property of PTOR, you might affect the device a lifetime. In fact, that you will have a diffusion of things into your active material. If that's a problem, this is one problem that you want to solve. On the other hand, at that time in UCLA, we were thinking about the transparent cells. And if you want a very good transparent electrode, at that time there is no silver nanowire, if you want an ITO, even high quality, then you need a sputtering process, okay? And very strict condition. And when you get this sputtering, it's a high energy process, your bombardment on your soft materials. And you can, of course, imagine that what will happen, right? It's either reducing shorts or something. Another thing that we talk about the polymer solid cells, that we want the our solution process, and in the end, many people will think, okay, there might be application for solution process, the electrode too, okay? And if you can realize that, you can get a complete rotor fabrication, okay? So, no matter which one, but if you have a solution process electrode, again, you have something that's with solvents that's on top of your soft material. So again, this could damage your active layer. So no matter what, that you are talking about protection of the active layers. Well, in regular devices, that if you don't want the calcium or barium, those lower function ones, then you can use what Sean introduced, lithium fluoride. Right? And lithium fluoride, that part, lithium fluoride, silicon fluoride, but typically you cannot make it very very thick. Those are intrinsically they are insulators, and to make them function, they are something like okay. you need tunneling, so you need to be seen. Or another mechanism is a decomposal of this one, lots of work on that. But basically, no matter what's the mechanism there, you cannot get a very, very thick upper layers on top. So if that's the case, we will not be able to do this sputtered TCO and solution process electrode. So, and if you take a look at the historical what we do, so we first found that, okay, metal oxide, that's what we talked about in last lecture, V2O5, molybdenum oxide, or the tungsten oxide, they can be as good as a P-dot. Okay, this is one piece of information. Okay, I can replace this one with metal oxide. On the other hand, the buffer layer part, the lithium fluoride, is one choice. And in that time, that Young's group is working with the cesium carbonate. And what's special about cesium carbonate is like, okay, if I use lithium fluoride as a buffer layer, the device's performance is still related to which kind of metals you use after it. For example, the lithium fluoride and aluminum works perfect. But if you use aluminum silver or aluminum gold, that's not good. But the property of this cesium carbonate is, okay, if I have that layers there in PLAD or OLED, then it's kind of intrinsically independent of your electrode. And why does that matter? Well, at that time, you think, okay, if I can, in regular device, after I get cesium carbonate, I can use any metal, right? Then, if I can reverse it, in this case, I have my high work function ITO, but the cesium carbonate may still function so that I can modify this ITO interface into a cathode part. So that's what we're our starting point. So what we see here is that yes, we can do, we do see the cesium carbonate can modify the ITO electrode into a cathode type. And then on top, we use thermal evaporated metal oxide there. So the device is relatively good no matter I do evaporated cesium carbonate or this one can be solution processed. I got those nice curves there. And we see the lithium fluoride in this case might have some limitation. This is the evidence that if I do lithium fluoride on top of ITO, the curve, we see an S curve there. Okay. This shows that cesium carbonate seems to work well with the PCBM in inverted configuration. And really, just to say, one issue of APL, then the other one that's Dr. Gini, Mr. White, Donna Olsen, and Sean here, they report this inverted solid cell tube. And the structure there is, you start with ITO, and you use the zinc oxide to modify the surface. So again, that shows a very effective way to modify the interface into cathode. So, and you use silver as an electrode, so that's a very nice piece of work. Well, I like this work very much in the sense that it's at that time that this is the EQE. I never get anything as high as here. And this is important in the sense that later that we typically, we see the model of a Schauber, right? You know, 65, right? And if you have a higher EQE, I think these days people start to realize more of it, and you have higher EQE, then that model's number will proportionally increase, right? And other things over the years, the other things that you can have is titanium oxide, either solid gel or another particle case, and there are titanium oxide with some polymer. After our initial cesium carbonate work, we also found that if I can anneal the cesium carbonate, I can improve the performance even better. And this is Florida's work very recently last year. That's basically you can get They use the zinc oxide and a polymer composite as an interface layer that in their new polymer systems, so you are able to get about 8% efficiency. I wrote 7 to 8 is because of the number of certified plus whatever test there. Of course, the degradation is always built in itself. So this slide says, okay, we can further improve the performance of inverted solar cell SP3HT. If silicon carbonate is used at room temperature, we get the performance of 2.3%. And we found that if we continuously heat anneal it somehow, this is just the silicon carbonate interface here. We still see a very big difference here. And in that case, we realized about the similar performance of the regular device. And what is the mechanism? And what we did work on UPS. It's lucky that Yang actually, in the early years, we managed to get funding to have an in-house UPS. So we see that this is the kinetic energy on IPO substrate. We clearly see the shift of the peak. So from that, we conclude that after we get this silicon carbonate thin layer, we are able to have an echo formation on top of the IPO, and you have this is familiar when we talk in other slides, that's the vacuum level shift. And we also see then in that case, why do you have a difference if you have this silicon carbonate? It's an inorganic material. When you heat it up, then why your performance increases? And what's the mechanism? And in addition to UPS, that's we do the X-ray photo emission spectroscopy, and we compare what's the peak from silicon and also the oxygen. And we find this is silicon peak upon annealing shift to higher binding energy. On the other hand, if you take a look at this oxygen, if you have a metal oxide, the peak is 530. This is a metal oxide. On the other hand, if the silicon carbonate, the oxygen peak is here. So when we do annealing from here, continuous anneal, then we see a shift. We see the difference between your metal oxide and silicon carbonate composition. So, as an example, the silicon and the oxygen ratio changes from 1.8 to 0.884 upon annealing. So all this information tells you that, okay, what happens in this annealing process is you have this silicon carbonate, once upon anneal it, you start to form more silicon oxides. Okay. Nowadays, people more and more realize what's the biggest advantage of inverted cell. This have two folds. In inverted cell, then you replace, you basically want, first thing, you can remove your no work function metal, so you had a longer stability. And here is a work. This is a Professor Alex Shin's work on flexible solar cell. And then he used the approach of zinc oxide as an electro to modify the IPO. So you see that in conventional glass device with lithium fluoride aluminum, I think it shows a very short lifetime, and this can be significantly improved when you use inverted structure, which there you do not have an active metal there. On the other hand, we explain that if you're in inverted structure, you are able to replace your top buffer layers with something that can be thick. mean, either metal oxide, then you go to say 20 nanometer or even higher, 30 nanometer, and then p-dot. And then people use p-dot on top of there, and that layer can go hundreds of nanometers thick. So with that's the advantage will be that it will allow you to do continuous roll-through fabrication in manufacturing process. And this is Krebs, Dr. Krebs' work in his institute in Denmark. And this is just to show you what's both the latest in inverted solar cell that's from Professor Frank Issel, that I think the student is sitting in here too. That's a very nice work. And you'll see from regular to inverted, you'll have, I'd say that's about 5 to 10% enhancement of UTV, which is very nice. And in fact, I think somebody told me that they get over 9% of inverted solar cells. And that's also that you start with a regular device about 8 point something, and you get 9%, which is exciting. So, okay, so inverted solar cells, put it as an example. And then Maurice has talked a lot about a very good introduction of multi-junction. I try to keep it short. So, classical paper, Shockley and Kinzer. So the efficiency peak is about, depending on band gap, your efficiency peak can be around 33%, okay, a single junction, okay? And here is the one that they adopted from this 2007 classical APO paper from Spectral Lab, which is a Boeing subsidiary. So they use this triple junction solar cells. They plot here like, okay, if I have a triple junction, you get a band gap 1, 2, and the third junction is 0.67 dB, which is, I think, is germanium. Then under the condition, what will be the efficiency limit? And you start to see the contour of going 54%, right? And for tandem, for going tandem, why is the tandem that good in efficiency? You significantly increase your photon utilization efficiency. This is a graph that adopted from Richard King of Spectral Lab in one of his presentations in, I think it's never. Okay, so if you, when we have a single junction, which is this blue line, okay? This blue line, in the optimized band gap, the photon utilization is, you see the blue line. The reason is simple, that for any photon that have energy that's lower than your band gap, you cannot generate anything, right? And after that, for any photons that have much higher energies there, then your VOC is fixed there. No matter you jump how high, that part of your VOC is fixed, so you have energy loss. So that's really when you see this tail. And if you can use a multiple junction, it's a three junction, for example, here, then the photon utilization efficiency, you now see this red curve, right? You see here, the one junction, another junction go here, and third junction go here, right? So obviously, the photon utilization efficiency is much higher, and basically, that you reduce your summarization loss. This is one of the state-of-the-art triple junction cells. And what I want to mimic is try to draw your attention is let's take a look of what's the band gaps there. You see here, the first one, 1.86 EV. Does this remind you of something in OPV? P30, right? Okay, you go second one, 1.4 EV. That's something that we are working hard to go beyond 800 nanometer or 900 nanometer. If you go to 900 nanometer, that's basically 1.4 EV. Yeah. So as a good practice, well, currently I don't think we have good ones that's like this one. So, but at least that we can practice something plus new low band gap polymer, and we can have tandem cell. early efforts there. Again, I said talk about things in polymer based and two terminals only. Okay, this one is a kind of a virtually two terminal in the sense that this is what is the work done in Groninger. So what they use is you have P3G and MHPPV. For those that probably new to the field, MDM OPV is the champion before we get the P3G champion. So bandgap about 2.1, I'd say. And what they found is they were able to get this polymer, PTBEHT, whatever. This is the low bandgap polymer. C is those 1,000 nanometer. And of course, let's say if you combine this part, it seems like a very nice combination for tandem application. Of course, that at the early days, that all solution process is for the interconnection layer is still a challenge. What this group managing to do is after the first cell, they get the lithium fluoride and aluminum evaporated, and then on top they use the gold and P dot. To build this tandem cell. Okay, so your solution process, vacuum process, solution process, and vacuum process. Okay. This one is a very nice. I still have this one a very nice concept, provable concept. So and overall, they will achieve about 0.57 tandem polymer solar cells. Not very good, but that's a very good starting point. And then Professor Janssen's group continues to solution process tandem work, and here is what they published in 2007. And now they were using zinc oxide as an N-type and modified P-dot. The reason for this is when you do multi-layer spin coating fabrication, you not always have the next layer being able spin coated on top of the other. So you need to modify the property so that you can coat the good films. And the bottom is the one that they show I can make double junction tandem solar cells and the P3G, PCBM, and MDMO, PPV, and PCBM. You see these two curves, a single junction, and when they put together, you get this. Yes, we do have a VOC heads up. Okay, that's one thing that's one big function of your interconnection layer. And you also have a triple junction here. And after that, I think about this part is not inside the paper, but probably other papers just copied that they show that I can make a six-fold junction. Okay, so and OMDMO PPV and the six-fold, you get a huge VOC, by stacking those things together. You see that's a two times one, and VOC I think is 3.5. Okay. If you think of one of any device that have 3.5 VOC, that sounds very fantastic, right? Well, independent of the efficiency, I think the concept here is that we start to have more experience in this interconnection, the solution process, interconnection layer, so that we can build a more or less robust kind of solar cell. And this is a paper that's published in Santa Barbara. This is Pongyi Li and Professor Heger has published in Science. That what they do here is they use a low band gap polymer, which is PCP, DTBT. This is the original that from Konaka, I believe. And that absorption goes to 900, and another one that goes to P3C, PCBN, that goes to cover what the, you know, that's a second of 50. Again, that seems like from spectral coverage wise, it's a nice combination. And what's in between, they use the titanium, their secret titanium oxide, very special, and PSS. So by doing that, they will able to show a 6.5% tandem PCE. And if you look at what's the single junction's performance, the low band gap gives you about 3%, and the P3HT gives you 5.7%. No, P3HT, single junction, and that's a single junction. Okay. So I think their low band gap polymer should be able to improve more. Then I would translate to what we do in what the use area do. So intrinsically, so we explain that the tandem we want to reduce the quantum or energy loss or summarization loss. So using the two cells in series, and the key point there is of course your compatibility of your polymers and also what you do with your single tandem junction. And as we discussed, the regular device and inverted device, and both of this can be engineered to make the tandem solid cell. Okay, one of the earliest work from Young's group is done by a system now in GE. The polymer selection is of course the P3HT. It's a well-known one, and there are PSBTBT, the one that you modify the carbon into silicon, and of course that improve the packing, blah blah. So they have a nice overlap. I will show you lots of slides. And in 2010, that's the group shows that okay, I can use a titanium oxide on top of PCBN. And then here in between, actually there is a evaporated aluminum layer. Okay. Well, we still have trouble of using just titanium oxide and PSS to form an effective tunnel junction there. So the aluminum clusters are introduced at the combination center, and on top that's the titanium oxide that is coming in. So it's not a totally solution process yet, but we are able to make that device about 5.9%. And the voltage adds up, and also you see the fuel factor. In the tandem, the fuel factor goes to 63%. It's quite a decent number. Of course, if you check what is the loss mechanism there, then we have two single junctions current, but this one is much lower there. Okay. So that's the part that we need to improve. A further improvement is actually coming from more coming from acceptor part. P3C PCBM gives you 4% efficiency, but introducing also this ICBA will give you a much larger VOC there. Okay, the VOC goes to 0.82, and the similar structure later translated to a much higher VOC, 0.2 eV, and still we keep a very nice fuel factor, so the PCE goes to 7%. Inverted work is always in the map in Young's group. So did the interconnection layer based on old metal oxide, that's molybdenum oxide to replace P dot, and also the zinc oxide. And in between, we still get aluminum as a recombination center. So this is the structure of this inverted tandem solar cell. You see the cross section. You see from what's the zinc oxide here. What is we have molybdenum oxide, and in between there's some aluminum and another zinc oxide. Basically, this is the interconnection here. In the inverted configuration. But for devices, initially that the material system are still the still the same, or have a nice spectral separation, and initially we get about a 5.1% efficiency. Those are early works, and for the interconnection layer, you need a high transparency, and that's what we have here. You see this black one, the highly transparent, so that interconnection layer will not reduce your current a lot. And then and then comes to the work we did in 2011 and 2012. And the important thing about this part of the work is that now that we do everything that's from zinc oxide to this layer, everything in solution process, there is no evaporation anymore. And we introduce this new new low bandgap polymers. This low bandgap polymer is a copolymer. One is the BDT unit. I introduce this a sulfing group there to improve the packing and the transport. This DPP unit has been shown that this one can give you lower bandgap. So take a look of for Tandem that you go with the spectrum, and we see that we have a very very nice separation of the spectrum. So, and for this new polymer, the energy band gap is 1.44 eV and P3T is 1.9. And what's the property for this one? This one is a CV, of course. This tells you what is your hormone level. Okay, we see that this one is the hormone is deeper than P3T, and of course when you work with PCBM, you get higher VOC. That's for single junction performance, and also that the modified of your molecules by introducing those sulfing group, etc. That makes this one have a high co-mobility that's comparable to P3T, which are all a good signs there. Because of that, so let's see, we make devices both in regular and inverted configuration, and they look very much comparable. And one important thing that I would want you to notice is, okay, the VOC. VOC is 0.72 watt. And what's the band gap? 1.4, right? 1.4 eV. Now that we were able to get 0.74 eV watt VOC from a very narrow band gap polymer, and you do not really sacrifice your current. And you see the it's quite nice EQE peak about 50%. And this is what we built for the Tandem solar cell. Since to November is we were able to get 8.3% current, and the fuel factor is quite nice. Okay. And the efficiency goes to 8.6%. And one thing that, as we are using P3T as a one junction, we still notice that this one has not fully released the potential of your polymer yet, right? With P3T, I think the rule of thumb is if we get 10 milliampere per centimeter square, that's a good number, right? We are still not there yet. So we did something that's not good yet. And the main thing is because I would say the EQE of this low bandgap polymer part is still not good enough. So and there is lots of room to improve in this new system. And so because we use an inverted structure, and we think the shelf lifetime looks pretty good. Very recently, Dr. Janssen's group also worked with DPP polymers a lot. They actually do DPP unit before us. And we're happy to see that they were able to use P.DSL and zinc oxide to make an inverted kind of solar cell that's very similar to us. And they were able to get, I think, 5.8% efficiency. And the main reason, I guess, is the lower VOC, which is lower than acid chloride due to this low band gap polymer, has a lower VOC. The energy level is not that good yet. But for the latest results in UCRA, that's it's this another low band gap polymer that's from Sumitomo. That's we were able to get a 10.6% efficiency. And why this one is important, I think that it's, I would argue that we start to almost fully reduce the potential of a P3C cell. See that the in tandem, that we get current 10.1, and that's not bad even for a single junction P3C device. So in the end of the part, I want to get a little bit of discussion of what's the limitation of OPV performance. And then we will well know this Schaber's graph. And there is under the assumption that the VOC will be equal to the donor donor acceptor homolumen offset minus 0.3, and the EQU 50%, the field factor 50%. And over the years, I think we have seen so many over 70% EQE. And we see 70 to 75% of field factor in OPV has been shown. So both of this leads to the modification of this graph. But we are still not too much there yet. What's our closest analog? We have DSSC, right? We see the DSSC, this is published last year in Science, that they were able to achieve 12.3%. And what's the difference there? And if you take a look of this, okay, absorption-wise, they do 700 something. The band gap-wise, it's probably not too much difference from what you use for PTB7 this time, right? So band gap about the same. But if you take a look of the EQE, okay, I like it. 90% EQE, right? So, and again, that's we over the years that we start to see the 80% EQE. That's this one is from NL, and this one is from Northwestern. Okay. So we start to have these good numbers there. And then if you go back to this, what we have in our tandem, and this is the EQE for this the two cells there. In both cases, we are talking about a peak around 60%. Okay, so that's the current part. In voltage part, this equation is well known, and more recently, that Nelson's group in Imperial College examined the what's your energy loss, and they said that okay, we will have the energy loss about 0.66 plus minus 0.08. Well, let's put it this way, that's 0.7 volts. And in which that exciton diffusion difference is about 0.35 eV. Another part, energy loss is due to the free carrier recombination. Okay, another part. So, and actually, if you take a look at this one, this part is. These two are quite equivalent in the sense that this part you basically also have this charge separation component there, and this is the experimental data for many devices. So if this is the upper limit there, are we there yet? I always want to ask this question. Actually, yes, we have good signs here. You see that this BDT TT. DPP polymer, band gap 1.4 eV, right? And your VOC 0.7. What's the difference? 0.7, right? So in this low band gap polymer, it's a very good low band gap polymer. Yes, we achieved it. But in the one that Sumitomo's polymer, we get the same thing here. Okay, that's very good. We actually laying behind is this high analytical polymer. P30, we played it for so long, 1.9 EV, and so far the best, say, the VOC in the best device is still less than 0.9 volt. Okay, so here we have a loss over 1. Let's have some dream then. How far can we go? Scenario. This is what we currently have. If we have an EQ increase to 80%, then nothing else changes, we get 14%. If this one can increase 90%, we got 16. Okay? So this is one dimension in current. And the work that you need to do is, I think, material and interface, and you also should have some optical part of the work. Then this is the current side of work, and also that as we see that we still have loss in voltage. What if we can realize the maximum VOC? If we keep the 60% current of the same, and we get a VOC and goes to 1.9 V. Well, basically the 1.2 is what we expect from the limit for P3T type, right? And simply this goes to 13%. And if you have a combination of your current versus and the voltage, and you can get your EQE in 90%. Oh, wow. That's magic, 90%. Okay. And in this case, we will be dreaming of 15% modulator. And if you can control your price at 50.3 per watt. Good. So you have a dream. So we have a dream. But are we just dreaming? I don't think so. If you I've stayed long enough in this field, so it goes to 2006, 2007. That's where we get the nice results on P3T. What I remember is that once we went to a conference, and Professor Lin Yangsen was there, and we chatted a little bit, and he said that, see, currently we have all the components there. What are the components there? The MOPPV's material, right? 2.1 EV. And we have a very good VOC, 0.8. And the P30G, we have a fuel factor, 70%, good. And we have this PCP DTBT. This is from Kanaka and later in San Marco. Okay, you see what they do? They can get 16 milliampere per centimeter square. And all we need to do is to realize them in one system. Okay. So at that time, so the dream is to go here, right? We combine all these good numbers there. And where are we nowadays? We have Mitsubishi Chemical, we have this U-Series, we have this PDF-TEC, but we all go past 11%, right? So yes, we are dreaming, but we are not just dreaming. So we are working hard on that. With that, let me summarize that it's a new technology, and we now just can realize over 10% efficiency through many directions, fundamental understanding, morphology, interface, we have this inverted structure plus tandem structure, and all the field is working very, very hard, okay? And so based on what we do, all these directions, we still have the dream, right? We have the dream that someday it will go to 20%. And shorter term, I think 2015, close to 15% should be very reliable. Okay, with that, again, let me thank my funding agencies and UC School of Engineering, and thank you all for your attention and all that.
So we'll continue on to lunch, and you can ask questions there. Okay? That's it for this session. Let's thank all of our